Former Panamanian dictator Manuel Noriega.
Hey, Chris.
Whoever the newscaster was starts kind of getting my attention.
Chris.
Saying like, hey, Chris. Hey, Chris.
Hey, Chris.
And it's saying, don't worry.
Everything's going to be okay. And one day, we'll be back.
This like sound, it wasn't like outside of my head, but it was just like inside of my head. It just sounded like a wash machine just kind of like out of balance or something, just like banging against the wall, and just really terrified me.
And in that moment I would hear tapping on the window. They would tap here. I would hear a tapping, and I'm thinking, well, maybe it's just a squirrel or a raccoon. But it was like a pattern. It was definitely a knock. And I would open my eyes and I'd look toward the window, and then it would stop.
I've always had a problem with states of consciousness, slipping in and out of different states of consciousness. And he looked just like a three-dimensional shadow, outline just perfect.
And he would walk, disjointed.
And he brought the vibration with him. It's as if it was emanating from him. And he would come towards me, and I would just feel that. I would hear all the sounds of hell. I don't know any other way to put it. And feel his awful vibration. And I would have a fight-flight response. And I would completely, you know, freak out and try to scream or get away.
And their skin was like television static. You know, it had, you know, like an old TV, when the signals, when you're not getting a good signal, it had that same kind of texture, that kind of
they meet a monster in their dreams, then what?
When I was, you know, we had HBO when I was little, and my dad was very liberal with letting us watch whatever we wanted to watch on HBO.
That guy is, like, in the opening credits coming through, like, this strange red tunnel, cloudy vortex thing. I think it's over the credit producer, Arnon Milchan. But like it went by in a flash, and it must have been, you know, kind of complicated to call into existence. So I was like, why was that there?
Before I went to bed every night, I would lay in my bed and close my eyes and just pray, not tonight, not tonight, not tonight, not tonight, not tonight, not tonight, not tonight. And I would just repeat it over and over and over in my head.
And another time, I actually felt it go on the bed. You know, it was as if it's climbing up. I was laying there.
When I was older and I went back to the house and was staying there, I mean, I hated going back to that house. You know, I had other bad experiences there. And so I hated going back there. I hated sleeping there. I would usually, if I go back there and visit, I leave the TV on because it's just such an overwhelming force. So I fell asleep and I had this nightmare. And then I woke up, and then I woke up in a sleep paralysis. And I was like, oh, you know. But I was so put off by the dream that I wasn't immediately shocked by the state of sleep paralysis, which normally is what it does. And I could kind of see out of the corner of my eyes that there was this man standing down at the end of my bed, kind of like a slumpy, like old man. And he says to me, he says, Forrest, you just came all over your mother.
You just masturbated all over your mother's bedsheets. You're disgusting. A pervert.
And I mean, I actually kind of believe that probably a lot of people who do believe that they have been abducted were actually victims of sleep paralysis of varying degrees.
and it came behind me. I was like this. It came behind me and it hugged me. And I heard the mattress depress also. I heard that depress, like someone went in the bed.
She goes like this, and suddenly she goes, oh, something's coming. And she had her eyes closed. And so she was not, could not see anything. And I was looking. And it was like she was listening and I was looking. And I looked into the forest and out came this blue form. Started approaching like this wavery blue thing.
Like yeah, the same quality of those black things that you talked about, but blue, peaceful, just really like nice. And she's like, oh, she's blue. She said she's blue. Eyes closed, you know, like this. And it came and approached and then it just kind of stood still. And it was like maybe like 6 feet, like over there. I'm getting goosebumps just thinking about this. And here's my girlfriend, and she's just like laughing a lot, like, oh, she's saying such the funniest things. Like, it's crazy. It was really crazy and weird. And she goes, oh, she says not to be worried about the demons behind you. And I was like, what? And I like turned around. And I saw them. That same face, the face that people see when they're abducted by aliens, the face that I saw as a small child. And then in that moment, I suddenly had this like kind of realization. Because it wasn't like linguistic, I didn't hear anybody talking to me, but I heard, I like felt a thought in my head, something external, and it was all about how fear empowers bad things. To have fear when you're in a bad environment or a bad place or around a bad thing only gives that thing more strength.